We're joined here in the studio by Dr. Alan Mendoza from the Henry Jackson Society. Welcome to the programme. How does this recognition, this official recognition of Jerusalem as the capital of Israel, help the peace process and a two-state solution?
Well, I think it's rather incidental to the peace process. The peace process has been 25 years old now. Currently, there is no peace process right at this moment in time. And what President Trump has said and stated in his speech is that it's time to recognise reality. Jerusalem has been the capital of Israel since 1948 in varying forms. And he stated it's not going to prejudge the final talks when and if they come. It's not about boundaries or division. It's just about recognising reality. The democratic ally can select its own capital.
How important in your mind is the idea of Jerusalem also as the capital of a future Palestinian state?
I think that's highly likely.
Right, well then it's not incidental then, is it, to the peace process?
Well, it doesn't preclude it. Why do you think that declaring Jerusalem the capital of Israel precludes it from being the capital of Palestine in a final status solution? I don't see the two things as being mutually incompatible at all.
Do you agree that actually it's just stating reality despite the sensitivities around this issue?
Absolutely not. I think this is a recognition of a capital in an occupied territory. It's contrary to British foreign policy. I'm delighted that the Prime Minister has condemned the move. I think that is the responsible thing to do. We've already seen that there is unrest, and what this will lead to is a worsening of the conflict situation there. People will be hurt and people's lives will be lost. This sets back a peace process which we know is incredibly fragile, and that's a dangerous move.
When you say that it's occupied, Jerusalem, you mean East Jerusalem is occupied, or are you saying the whole of Jerusalem is occupied?
East Jerusalem is recognised as occupied.
Right, but West Jerusalem as the capital of Israel, you are happy with?
Well, I don't think what you can have is a capital in a territory which is so fraught in this peace process. It demonstrates a suggestion. I don't agree that what you can say is for a democratic ally to name its capital, just as we can't say that we want our capital to be Paris or somewhere else in the world.
In your mind, what is the capital of Israel?
So the capital of Israel is Tel Aviv, and that is the way that it must remain.
No, it isn't. The capital of Israel is Jerusalem, because the Israelis have controlled Jerusalem since 1948, the western part. They then, of course, extended control to eastern Jerusalem in 1967. For you to suggest that Tel Aviv is not the capital of Israel, or rather Tel Aviv is capital of Israel, is like the same as Israelis saying that Manchester is the capital of Britain.
But how inflammatory is it of Donald Trump to make what will be seen as an unnecessary move to actually announce that they're going to transfer the embassy from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem when it's been perfectly fine in Tel Aviv all this time?
Well, when you say it's unnecessary, I think Donald Trump is looking to spark a process and move things on. We've not been able to get peace talks going in the last X number of years.
And as I say, how will this help spark the peace process when Hamas in the Gaza Strip has said they might actually call, or they have already called, for a new intifada, a new uprising?
Well, Hamas is not party to the peace talks. Hamas is not part of the peace process. It hasn't been part of the peace process for 25 years. There's no indication it's going to be part of the peace process going forwards. The real question is, will President Abbas return to the negotiating table, which he's been asked to do on numerous occasions?
And this has made it much more difficult for him.
I don't think it will. I think on the contrary, I think what he needs to understand is that Palestinians cannot continue to be the blocking party to this. Israelis have, for the last 25 years, put deal after deal on the table, and the Palestinians, starting with Yasser Arafat, moving to Abbas, have walked away from those deals. It's time to say to the Palestinians, there are consequences. The world moves on. We can't be frozen in the paradigm of 1993-94 forever.
Right. I'm just going to bring in my colleague, diplomatic correspondent James Landale, onto the programme to talk briefly about Boris Johnson and what he said. Because, James, you've been listening to that speech. We talked a little earlier about a response to the comments made by Michel Barnier about whether Britain would be able to stand shoulder to shoulder with the EU in the future on security. Just tell us what he's been saying.
Well, I have to say the Foreign Secretary gave, we use the phrase wide-ranging for speeches. Actually, he did range over a great deal. He did, without mentioning Michel Barnier, put a little push back and say, look, actually, no, by leaving the European Union, the UK is in no way stepping back from the fight against Islamic terrorism. On Israel, he was very interesting in terms of what you've just been discussing in terms of the US decision to recognize Jerusalem as the capital, because he said the onus is now on the United States to go further and say, OK, they've made this, they played this card on Jerusalem. The US now has to make play another card on the wider Middle East peace process and say, look, this is what the brokerage, the role that the United States can play there. So trying to put more pressure back on the United States. And also, more broadly, over the issue of Brexit, Boris Johnson was inevitably asked about that. And what he said there was he said that any deal had to be UK-wide, any offer to the DUP. He also said and made it very, very clear that anything had to ensure that, once again, to use his phrase, Britain secured control over its borders and its money. As ever, maintaining a pretty hard position on that.
James Landale, thank you very much. Alan Mendoza, let's pick up on what James said, that Boris Johnson actually says the onus is now back on the United States. What should be done to bring Mahmoud Abbas and the Palestinians then to the table?
Well, I think the drive is actually happening right now. You've seen for the last few months a move by the President Trump and the administration to bring in the wider Arab world to this question, to this issue.
How? What have they done that will bring Mahmoud Abbas to the table?
He needs to be pressured by Saudi Arabia in particular and by the Gulf states to come back to the table and say we want an overarching settlement in light. And what they're using, as you've probably seen, is the threat of Iran to bring everyone together.
Right, but actually Saudi Arabia has condemned this move. So in what way will it help Saudi Arabia get involved, as you say, when they have been united to some extent over the issue of Iran, to actually pull the Palestinians
because
into
it's incidental. This is not an important point in the great scheme of things.
It's very important to the Palestinians. It's absolutely critically important
to the
Palestinians.
But not to the Saudis and not to others in the region. What you will see happen is the continued moves between the Israelis, the Saudis, other Gulf states, other parties who are worried about the Iranian threat coming together. This will be a kink in the road, nothing more than that, and it will go back to being that alliance strategy.
On the basis of Donald Trump's track record, do you think this was really thought through, that there really is a strategy in the way that you have outlined? Isn't this, again, clumsiness on behalf of the president, where in this case, as Martha has indicated, it could end up with violence?
No, I don't think so. I think if you look at what he's been saying for the last 8 months on the issue of Middle East peace, there is a plan there. There's a plan that's been executed by moving, by going to the Gulf, going to Israel, trying to bring the parties together, working behind the scenes. This is the next step in that. There will be other steps to follow.
Alan Mendoza, thank you. Now it's time for...